So, good morning. Good morning. Welcome to A Voice from Heaven. And we were already listening to it. It's like, oh, listen. A voice from heaven is speaking to us. So today, the whole idea of the happy dream has come to us. So this is basically where chapter 18 is famous for. And we have in our, say, so-called past, had many ideas about a happy dream. We try to build it, we try to make it, we try to do everything we can to get that together. And we have come to the conclusion that we failed and started looking for an alternative. This is what happened to the happy dream as we described it as human beings. Now, it doesn't stop there, luckily. So today we continue with, in fact, looking at the happy dream in a whole new perspective, something that has nothing to do with what we thought before or what we thought of as a happy dream before. So this is easier than you think. And it's like, well, can you keep, can you in fact stay in that? We want to achieve it, but then stay in it. We want the continuation of that. And so all these things are coming up as ideas about the happy dream. And what is a happy dream? Like, what is so characteristic about a happy dream? How could that look? I can easily let you say yes to it. It's like, yes, that's what I want. I want a happy dream. Because I know the dream that I have most of the time isn't a happy dream at all. There's so much stuff going on. It seems like that. So let's take a look at what is given in this chapter, because it's literally out of this world. And this is not something to discuss. No, this is something to recognize. And it is the loveliest thing you can receive for yourself. So that's one part of the today's meeting. And the other part is, of course, expanding the holy instant as, say, the master of the expansion of holy instants, or the master of the happy dream, will show us how to expand the holy instant. And that is very lovely too. It's like, okay, so now you have the rising up of your heart, you have the lifting, the upliftment of your heart, that would be the expression, like the upliftment of your heart, which is a really lovely idea. The upliftment of your heart happens spontaneously. Now, it is not under your conscious control. And this is the part that's maybe the most difficult to accept about the holy instant or about the happy dream in the first place. The happy dream is not under your conscious control either, just as the holy instant isn't. But that's a good thing, because your your control does not give you a happy dream. You've tried that. It's like, well, there's no fun in you controlling your dream. There's no fun in it. Like, a dream in its happiness should be free to be itself. Now, that's the place where we go to. And see, a happy dream is still a temporary dream, you could say. And does it have anything to do with this world? Well, no. You're, of course, you find yourself in a world, but in consciousness, you're not. And this is where where something is really given in terms of instruction to us. It's like, oh, don't forget about this. Like, oh yeah, wait a minute. If I'm tempted to to be, say, in time, if I'm tempted to think that any of this in time that appears to be in time has any reality or value, then I'm stuck in a dream. But that will not be a happy dream. No, that's a, like, if you value anything from a limited perspective, you're caught in it. And we saw this mechanism many times. We say that's, I keep repeating that, in other words. So now, these two ingredients will make it like to an amazing opportunity for your, basically, for you becoming present here now. That's what this is about. It's like dislodgement from any time-related ideas. Recognition of your willingness to for the alternative. Being open and receptive, having an open consciousness, having a clean altar to receive what is given. I'm just summarizing here. Now we're getting somewhere. Like, you in your high expectancy are opening your consciousness for something else to occur that is beyond your control, but totally, say, possible for you to accept it. So that's what's being offered. So I'm going to share with you some visuals I made for this from the Urtext of A Course in Miracles, Volume 1, and this is the textbook, Chapter 18. Now, here's an interesting statement to start with. Prepare you now for the undoing of what never was. See, that's a great practice. I love that. Prepare now for the undoing of what never was. This is a Zen koan. This is an instruction that literally is a key, is a portal, is a koan, is a total Zen expression. Prepare you now for the undoing of what never was. Yeah? So that's so incredible. If you already understood the difference between truth and illusion, atonement would have no meaning. Yeah, so there's apparently a confusion between truth and illusion. In your experiences of yourself, you have made illusions real and think that that's you, and that you are a time-related object floating around in the universe, for instance. And here, so there's something there that can, yeah, that you need to take a look at, you could say, and that needs to be undone in you. So prepare you now for the undoing of what never was. All the temporal ideas that you hold, for instance. If you already understood the difference between truth and illusions, atonement would have no meaning. But atonement will have meaning for you. Atonement will have meaning for you because you have confused truth and illusions. The holy instant, your holy relationship, the Holy Spirit's teaching, and all the means by which salvation is accomplished would have no purpose if you knew the difference between illusions and truth. Now, I can tell you this, that when you experience an holy instant, you're so happy that that occurs, that you know that you want more of that, but you also know that you're full of something else, you could say. You're literally are happy when a holy instant happens now and then, instead of expanding it into eternity. So it's like you're holding on to the illusion is still great, it's like still profound, and there's not really a reason for it, but a holy instant will help you to undo, to in fact start to learn to trust the alternative. So I'll repeat once more. The holy instant, your holy relationship, the Holy Spirit's teaching, and all the means by which salvation is accomplished would have no purpose, for they are but aspects of the plan to change your dreams of fear to happy dreams. Dreams of fear to happy dreams, from which you awaken easily to knowledge. So it's like an intermediate, like a borderland where you enter into. You change your dreams of fear are changed into dreams of happiness, from which you awaken easily to knowledge. Then it's not such a big step to come to knowledge. And knowledge is not understanding. Knowledge is not anything intellectual. No, knowledge is knowing. So that is a whole different spiel in that sense. Which is really good to know, that there's differences in that. So this is just an intermediate and borderland. Put yourself not in charge of this, for you cannot distinguish between advance and retreat. Like, you don't even know when you're going forward or backward. You have no idea. You cannot evaluate yourself. Now, we say this many times too. It's like, you can't evaluate yourself because you don't know the difference between advance and retreat. Some of your greatest advances you have judged as failures. Many of them. And some of your deepest retreats have you evaluated as success. Well, this is where the trouble starts, you could say. So your greatest advances, you have judged as failures. So you have experienced them as failures too. You thought like, well, I'm not able to do this. I think honestly, in most of the, say, healing moments that I share with whoever, this is always the point. You evaluate yourself and you think that it went wrong. Well, because you came to the conclusion, I cannot do it. I tried everything and it didn't work. I'm so sick and tired of my own thoughts. See, these are great advances. These are great conclusions to come to. These are actually the basics of awakening. So it's like, that's a great advance if you come to the place where you actually are willing to admit, oh my God, this failed. I have no idea how to do this. I cannot do this. I don't know how to do any of this. I don't even know what to think anymore. So, well, that's great. Congratulations. It's really like that. But I think most of my healing encounters have always to do with an evaluation of oneself, in which you come to the conclusion, I failed. And I say, congratulations, you failed. Wonderful, great. That's a great accomplishment. And some of your deepest retreats you have evaluated as success. Like, oh, I'm doing so much better now. I'm doing so much better. I have moments that I feel happy and all this. Or who knows, like you can relate to that with an idea that you were successful. Well, see, actually nothing happened. Something like this. It's like, in the days that you really go deep into the feelings that you have and feel so incredibly stuck and so hopeless, well, that is great. That is great. More is happening in your undoing. You feel the conflict so profound in your consciousness. Great. Something is happening. Like that, there is more happening in that moment than if you feel lofty and fantastic and, say, somewhere up in the sky. Like, that is not what this is about. So that's good to remember. Even in the undoing, in the temporal happy dream, yeah, you have days that are so tough, but you know something is happening. You know that it's all part of the plan, you could say, in letting you see, This is the undoing of what never was. So whatever you think you're losing in this moment, you don't want. You don't want to hold on to it because you don't want it in the first place. Never approach. So here's an instruction. So never approach the holy instant after you have tried to remove all fear and hatred from your mind. That is its function. Never attempt to overlook your guilt before you ask the Holy Spirit's help. That is his function. If you feel guilty, feel totally guilty. Don't try to overlook it. Don't try to spiritualize yourself out of it. If you feel totally shitty, so to speak, try not to get out of it. No, just ask for help. That is the Holy Spirit's function. So never approach the holy instant after you have tried to remove all fear and hatred from your mind. It's like, no, let him do that. Feel all the fear, feel all the hatred, feel all the abandonment, feel all the distress, feel all the, and on and on and on. Feel it completely and ask for help. It's like when Spirit is, say, helping you with that, it is going to be healed in a way that it does not have to come back that way. No, there's an opening of communication. So that's why this is important. It's like self-management, forget it. It's over. You cannot do that anymore. Your part is only to offer him a little willingness to let him remove all fear and hatred and to be forgiven. On your little faith, joined with his understanding, he will build your part in the atonement and make sure that you fulfill it easily. Easily. And with him, you will build a ladder, planted in the solid rock of faith and rising even to heaven. Nor will you use it to ascend to heaven alone. See, this is so great. So now, okay, we'll start to see how this works, actually. Your part is only to offer him a little willingness to let him remove all fear and hatred and to be forgiven. On your little faith, joined with his understanding, which is omniscience, by the way, he will build your part in the atonement and make sure that you fulfill it easily. And with him, you will build a ladder, planted in the solid rock of faith and rising even to heaven. Nor will you use it to ascend to heaven alone. No, you start to recognize your brothers who are also ascending to heaven with you. Like, no, this is a joint venture. Like, recognizing you are one with everyone. Like, yeah, absolutely. Through your holy relationship, reborn and blessed in every holy instant, reborn and blessed in every holy instant, which you did not arrange, like without your conscious doing, thousands will rise to heaven with you. Can you plan for this? Or would you prepare yourselves for such a function? Yes, it is possible because God wills it. Because God wills it. So through your holy relationship with God, reborn and blessed in every holy instant, which you did not arrange, thousands will rise to heaven with you. Can you plan for this? Or could you prepare for such a function? Yet it is possible because God wills it. Now, how are we doing that? Happy dreams come true. Not because they are dreams, but only because they are happy. And so they must be loving. Their messages thy will be done, and not I want it otherwise. No, thy will be done. That's our mantra. Thy will be done. Thy will be done. Happy dreams come true because they're happy. So they're loving. And all of their messages will be, thy will be done. The alignment of means and purpose is an undertaking impossible for you to understand. And I just keep reading because it's too interesting. The alignment of means and purpose is an undertaking impossible for you to understand. Well, I don't even understand this sentence, so yes. The alignment of means and purpose is an undertaking impossible for you. You do not even realize you have accepted the Holy Spirit's purpose as your own. You do not even realize that. And you would merely bring unholy means to its accomplishment. The little faith it needed to change the purpose is all that is required to receive the means and use them. This is also beautiful. You have accepted the Holy Spirit's purpose as your own. That's why you find yourself here in this spiritual awakening process, you could say. So, listen, follow. You don't know how to do this. Okay, great. Just having a little faith in it. The little faith it needed to change the purpose is all that is required to receive the means and use them. Okay, so here we have another kind of prayer. But just as this is impossible, so it is equally impossible. It's equally impossible that the holy instant come to either of you without the other. I desire this holy instant for myself, that I may share it with my brother, whom I love. It is not possible that I can have it without him, nor he without me. Yet it is wholly possible for us to share it now. And so I choose this instant as the one to offer to the Holy Spirit, that his blessing may descend on us and keep us both in peace. Thy will be done, right? So I desire this holy instant for myself, that I may share it with my brother, whom I love. It is not possible that I can have it without him, nor he without me. Yet it is wholly possible for us to share it now. And so I choose this instant as the one to offer to the Holy Spirit, that his blessing may descend on us and keep us both in peace. See, the difficulty, you could say, the difficulty that can come up now in your mind is that you think that would be difficult for you to do. And in fact, it is like, well, the difficult part is basically in accepting the fact that so little is asked of you that you might be offended that only that is asked of you. Like, maybe not consciously, but subconsciously, you can feel a resistance to receiving this just because it's the easiest thing in the world, you could say. It's like it's the easiest. And sorry, no, there's not an important role for you in that sense. It's like it's not an accomplishment on your part. It is not a competitive strive or anything. It is not about you can do it better than someone else. It is not that I can do it. Here, look, I can do it. Yes, I can do something that you cannot do. No, that... And that's funny, isn't it? So it's like that, sorry, that's not included in the holy instant or in the happy dream. It's like, no. Your part in this is just this little willingness, to to have that happen to your brother and you, to share it immediately. Like, this is an invitation to share. And not sharing words or ideas, no, to share the love that you recognize your brother to be. In your recognition of your love for your brother, you start to recognize that that's actually you. In that, you can say, like, you become so happy that immediately you feel connected to your creator. Like, it is as simple as that. It is not so difficult. So how good does it feel to actually express your love to your brother? How good does that feel to express that? And what happens then? In fact, there's no defense at that point. There's no competition. No, there's a shared moment of union and joining. That is all. And we can make a big deal out of it. Or we can make it as an intense or difficult process of what. It's like, no, it's as easy as you allow yourself to melt into the love that you are. The love as you were created. Thy will be done. Thy will be done. You only have to allow yourself, in fact, or be willing to be melted into love. That's the whole story. How can you have a happy dream? Well, stop defending yourself. Stop defending yourself. Stop comparing yourself. Stop competing. And all of this, it's like, stop wanting things a certain way to come to you. Wanting things a certain way. No, it is given in every moment. Like, in every moment, it is literally given to you. And that is, if you accept that, it is perfect. There's nothing wrong with that. So how easy that is, in fact. So, but it will stir up all kinds of feelings, like fear, anger, and all these things. Now, you have been accustomed to trying to deal with those feelings and trying to solve them. And this part, you don't have to do anymore. It's like, no, that did not work out. No, we decided not to continue that project of self-help. No, the project self-help has finished. It is way over. It is way over. It absolutely never worked. So stop trying. It's not necessary to repeat a lesson that you could have learned. So here's your possibility to learn that lesson and give everything to the Holy Spirit before you try to solve it, not afterwards. So it's like, oh yeah, that makes sense. Never thought of it. I never thought of it. Yeah, that absolutely makes sense. Let's ask for help before I try to solve things. That's so great. It's like, that's so lovely. And then you will see that it can easily dissolve. And what happens to you? You become glad and happy. It's like, it's resolved. Oh my God, it looked so impossible. In my mind, it looked so impossible. And I felt already the anger building. And I really thought, well, this time I'm going to do it right. But you forgot that you have no idea what right is and wrong is. Like, it doesn't work that way at all. So get out of the way with your great ideas and remember, thy will be done. It's like, it's four words, it's very easy. Thy will be done. And then you say thank you. And in fact, that is everything. So how to stay in the happy dream then? Thy will be done. I accept this moment as it is. I'm willing to give everything to my brother in that sense. I'm willing to give all my love to my brother because I recognize that I cannot go home without him. I cannot just say like, okay, adio, see you later. I'm going to heaven. Forget it. You stay here. Okay, good. Like, no. No, that story we've seen in many religions. Like, I'm doing the right thing and I shoot you down. for instance, like that. Like, no, you're lost. I can kill you. It doesn't matter anymore. That was and still is practice on a daily basis in this crazy world, you could say. That is practice. Did it work? No, absolutely not. Of course not. So here we are, recognizing that the one that you point your gun at, so to speak, is the one that's going to save you. And that, yeah, it's like you can receive that now. You don't know how to do that, but take down your armament, take down your defense and attack mode. Stop with an eye for an eye. Stop doing that. Look here. There's a possibility for a happy dream, a shared dream of happiness and unity, equality. How about that? You're equal. No matter what your background was, you're equal. You're absolutely equal. We share a common source. We share the love of the universe, which created us. All the other sidetracks were just a spin of the mind, thinking that it knew something, that it wanted it a certain way. Now this moment is complete in itself and is given to you to share with your brother. So in that, you become so happy in receiving that. You become so happy that you don't know what to do with yourself. That's one thing. But also, it's like, you can call that a holy instant. What do you want to do when you feel happy? You're grateful. You say, thank you, God, I can't believe it. Thank you. I had nothing to do with this, and it's just given freely. Oh my God, I'm going to accept that. Thank you. So now, the master of expanding the holy instant, I'm going to share with you and talk of master teacher. 20 minutes, I think, is the dose of today. And I love to share it with you and enjoy it with you. So thank you so much for your attention so far.
Have you been undergoing holy instances in the last hour? Yeah, that's what's happening to you. Can you feel it? Yeah. Have you been undergoing holy instances in the last hour? Yeah, that's what's happening to you. Can you feel it? Yeah. Did you pull it back down into your own false crap in reality? I hope not. Because each moment I'm offering you salvation. You say, this is too good to be true. No, it's not. I'll get you now, get you later. And there is only now for me. There might be later for you, but that won't do you any good. Who did you think your Savior was? I'm here. I'm telling you this now. All I'll ever do is tell you this. You say, well, later on, somebody else is going to tell me. No, that'll be me. Isn't that funny? You don't like to hear this. Can anybody really, you guys hear me? How many can really hear this? Obviously, one separate self-identity would be the same as it all. You can divide up and judge your Savior all you want to do. But it's through your judgment of Him that you deny His Saviorship. It's impossible I'm not your Savior. It's literally impossible because I'm standing here telling you I am. Not only that, but I know it. Are you required to know that I'm your Savior? It has absolutely nothing to do with you, but you're not going to like this because I'm going to say to you, if you persist in your own perceptual mind, you have no reality to me. That's what your salvation depends on. Your determination to see that as you present yourself to me, you have no reality. Otherwise, you'll continue to judge me in our associations, which are what our falsity is. All right? All an awakened mind does, and some of you guys are really beginning to do this now, is declare to the student his own unreality. Let it go. All of your judgments of what I am are false. Okay? I'm making a declaration of a whole mind to you. All judgment is false. Each time you come to me, and you've asked for me as an advanced teacher, I will deny your relationship with me and tell you that you're whole and perfect. You are determined that you will bring your self-identity to a whole mind, and it's not possible for you to do that. Literally not possible. But remember that I can only be a projection of your mind, okay? And through your relinquishment of judgment of me, you will be saved and whole and remember heaven. This is Course in Miracles. This is what I'm teaching. Subjective reality. Am I really in your dream telling you this? Yeah. Did you really hear this in your dream? Yeah. How else would you be hearing it now? It's impossible that you do anything in time that you haven't already done. Isn't this so? Tell me something that you haven't already done. Come on. Well, you can't. You say, I don't know what I haven't already done. Well, sure you do. As soon as you tell me, it's already done. Why? Perception is always past tense. Everything has already happened. You're just reliving in your own dream. You keep reliving the same dream over and over. You play different parts of it. This is lovely, chapter 26 in the Course. Okay? It's just your dream. Well, where will the world be when you're not here? Nowhere. There isn't any such thing as a world. Jesus in the Course. You really think that you came here at a particular time with the world only waiting for you to be saved? Not so. You brought the world with you when you came. You brought all of, what does Jesus call them? All of these shadow figures, he called them. You brought all of these shadowed figures with you to justify your relationships and your separation. That's what you've always done. You've been wrong, you've been untrue from the beginning, haven't you? Is this too good to be true or too bad to be true? Sure. But it is. Okay. Now you find yourself in a very uncomfortable situation. You can jump up. This is love. I'll give you these quotes from the Course. You can jump up and run out of here because of fear of what I'm telling you. Yeah, it's very fearful to you. It doesn't seem as though it would be fearful, but it is. I'm now threatening you with your own reality. This is that barrier that you need to pass in the relinquishment of your own perceptual form. Jesus says this is the illusion of thought forms that you have constructed to keep yourself from seeing the reality of the light that's all around you. Literally, you have done this. You have capped, what? Your own perceptual mind. All right? That's fearful for you. Okay. All of the admonitions of the minds about you that you think our minds will say, don't do this. Don't decide to make this commitment. Okay? You're at your point of fear. Now, always before you have turned back from this. Okay? This time you're not going to. Why? I'm here to help you at that point. Okay? I'll sustain that for you very easily, but I can't do it for you. See, it's only in your own mind, right? Nobody can do it for you. You say, well, Master, why don't you do this for me? I can't. I can declare to you that through your own whole mind, you can see that I am with you at what you call the portal of reality. Jesus calls it what? The borderland. He says you stand now at the borderland where things are no longer holding in your illusions as much as they used to. This is lovely, Course. He says, now sometimes you go into a little different dream, and then you get fearful and you fall back down into this dream. And then what? You say, no, I don't want this dream. I'm going to die in this dream. Then what do? You relinquish and you go through another experience. Now what am I teaching you? Holy instant. Feel this? When I begin to teach at a high level, you begin to feel this energy. Why? I'm releasing my own conceptual necessity to teach you. If I do that, I will leave here. I'm held together by this momentary necessity to present this to you. These are the direct teachings of Jesus Christ. Just for that moment, I retain an image memory of you, okay, in my own memory, although I know it is not real. So I can declare to you, no, this is not real. If you will accept that from me in your mind, you will shorten, Jesus says, you'll shorten time immeasurably. You'll collapse it. What? You won't have to continue to experience the pain and frustration of your attempts to hold yourself separate from reality in your own dream. You should take hold of this too instead of kicking this around. You got to have to understand that it's an experience that you need to undergo. You think I don't know you guys? I know all you guys perfectly. There were only 12 of us to start out. Do you think I don't know you out of time? Don't be absurd. How many do you think there were of us? I'm here to tell you the war's over. Further than that, I'm here to tell you it never happened. Were we all part of the original screw-up? Yes. Yes, we all share that original moment together. Can you see this? Now, where are we finally in time? We've come back to that original moment. We've made a full circle again. We're back at the time of the actual occurrence, and this is very fearful to you. Because the momentity of that single happening is so intense that you just defend yourself from it. The necessity now is to look at it without fear. Say, no, I'm not going to go back out again. I'm east of Eden in the land of Nod. Okay? I'm not going to go back out into Nod and sleep again. This time, I'm going to hear it. Okay? All consciousnesses who come to me in this relationship are different. And this was my talk last night. Many of you can remember your previous death experiences. A lot of you, when you were born into this episode, just went, oh, what am I doing here again? How did I end up here again? How did I get in this crazy place? How come I'm different than these other consciousnesses around here? I'll tell you why. You can remember your last intimate death association. And at that time, because of the pain you felt at that termination of bodily function, you underwent a bright light realization. And subsequently, because you had not undergone the total exponential experience, had to come back into another association. This is a little occult. I don't know why you hear it. I'm giving you a fact here. Now, what am I inducing in the holy instant? The death experience. I'm literally inducing this light brightness that you felt at your last episode of death. Have you ever seen a bright angel of light around a dying? Have you been around people that died much? Some of you healers, or so-called healers, that have been around consciousnesses that have died, have had the experience I have a lot when I used to work with dying people, of actually seeing the release of their own energy and the actual extension from their chakra, lovely light and energy will come around them, and they will exalt, many times they'll exalt the Lord. I've heard declarations of New Jerusalems and all of this new bright association as they what? Apparently depart the body. Is this what you're undergoing now? Of course. What did you think you're undergoing? Now, what you're going to do is undergo it with a full realization of all of the memories that you have brought with you into this configuration. Nicodemus, know ye not ye must be born again? This is that happening, that death experience that you're afraid of. In order for you to be born again, you must undergo the death. Okay, here's the top teaching. Each moment this is occurring. Each moment, time lasts but a moment, and you are living within that moment, all of your so-called death experiences. You guys that begin to read the Course entirely differently than you've ever read, these are direct quotes from the Course in Miracles. You can stretch that into 50 years or 80 years or 100 years if you want to, but it was only a moment. And each moment it is available to you to come back into eternity through the relinquishment of time in your association with yourself. I guarantee you that that's true. Course in Miracles. Is it possible for you to come into the holy instant and live in it for the remaining of your time? That's what these new minds have done. This mind, these minds. The light begins to shine out of their reassociations with themselves. Can you get this by judgment of them? Don't try. Don't try. That's the fallacy, isn't it? Oh, gee, I can see that he's undergone an experience. I wish that could happen to me. Nonsense. He's a projection of your mind and a denial of the experience that you must undergo. Do not judge your brother in his spiritual acuity, his capacities to undergo what these consciousness are doing. This is a process of individual atonement. Your sole function here is to undergo this experience for yourself, for indeed you are the world, aren't you? And that's what's happening to you, and that's what you're doing. Be grateful that you got a shot at this, right? You'd be happy with the idea that it's possible for you to lay down the necessity for you to die and get sick. Okay. I understand that the world is going to say, stay with us. You've constructed them to do that. I understand that the world is going to declare to you that you shouldn't throw all your eggs into God. Let's not go off the spiritual deep end. Let's stay grounded here so that you can get sick and die with the rest of us. You do that. Okay. Am I an alternative for you in that? Sure. Like Jesus says, will the world despise you and crucify you for teaching it? Exactly. Why? That's what they are. If I could take this up just a step for you, I'd like you to see how really little you've identified yourself here. You insist that you're a body. Jesus calls it little. You're just so little. You look up at the stars and you say, well, those stars are 1,000 trillion miles away from you. That's absurd. The furthest star is right here. The furthest galaxy you can see is this neighbor right here. This is a galaxy. We are establishing intergalactic association. What did I have to do that first? I have to take my microcosm in the distance in my subatomic particle association, which is exactly the same as out there. I have established interstellar drive with my own relationship. All right, I had to do that before I could go intergalactic. Okay, each human being is, Jesus calls you a constellation. And that's okay, perhaps a galaxy is a better word. Okay, until you had interstellar drive, you had to fight the distance of your own chakra, which you call in Revelations your own church. Well, it took you 10,000 light years to get from your stomach association to your mind. You tried to do it at the speed of light. But remember, measured subatomically, the distance from your stomach to your head is approximately 18,000 light years. There's just exactly as much smaller than you as there is bigger. Can you hear any of this? Okay. The whole universe that's contained in you is precisely the universe that's all around you. This is a Katha Upanishad. I keep falling back into this other stuff. As above, so below, as within, so without. You don't mind that, but your conceptual mind wants to make it symbolic. It's not symbolic. You are the universe. Everything that you do is all that the universe that there is. The only thoughts there could ever be in the universe are the ones that you are having. If you say there is no God, there is none. But there is, therefore you are not real, and by maintaining that there is none, you have separated yourself and made yourself unreal. The consciousness that declares that is not real, and it never happened. Ready for the biggie. This never happened. It's impossible that this, look around you for crying out loud. It's like you're standing in a real small place. It's like you fell into a well and we're fishing you out. I'm in a little line down now. Take a hold of the darn thing and I'll pull you out. Instead of trying to keep turning around within your own dream, you got knocked out. You're hallucinating. You're asleep. You're dreaming. This isn't real. I'm right in the middle of your dream telling you to wake up, okay?
Desire this holy instant for myself, that I may share it with my brother. whom I love. It is not possible that I can have it without him, nor he without me. Yet it is wholly possible for us to share it now, and so I choose this instant as the one to offer to the Holy Spirit, that his blessing may descend on us and keep us both in peace. Thank you.